Very good morning to you all. Say that yet, and trust that you will know that our Jesus is alive, and that you will discover that you will, that will be apparent to you today, especially as we honor the fact that he's not dead, he is alive. When we lived in Cape Town, I used to regularly listen to, whenever in the car, I used to listen to talk radio, 567, the equivalent of 702 for those of you who come from up north. And people would phone in, and of course it was sponsored by different organizations, different businesses that sponsored the talk show. And one day there was an ad that came on for it was from a liquor outlet, and it was for a special price on whiskey. And at the end of the ad, the announcer said, "What better way to celebrate Easter?" And I thought, where have we gone to? But I hope that this morning, somehow, you've been able to celebrate, even just slightly, the fact that Jesus is alive and there's no whiskey involved. And then we've got Norman just reminding us that there'll be coffee after the 10 o'clock service. Whenever I work through the Easter story, there's something inside me says that, you know, there's a sense in which I am glad I was not alive at that time. And the reason I say that is because I sometimes wonder where I would fit in. Would I be a Peter? Would I be a Pharisee? Would I be part of the crowd? Where would I be as that Easter story unfolded? And sometimes it bothers me that I would find myself not courageous enough to be supportive of. After the crucifixion, the Saturday, the disciples were still in disarray. They must have wondered, how has it come to this? In fact, they did wonder. None of us here has ever watched our friend being tortured to death. Saturday must have been a very long day. And each of them knowing, working through their own stuff, whatever it was that they had to work with. And then suddenly they hear that Jesus is alive. And that resurrection of Jesus transformed everything. Even though when they were first told the fact that Jesus had risen by the women, there's this lovely phrase that says, "For their words seemed to them as her words seemed to them as nonsense." It can't be, they said. But this morning, I want us to briefly look at the mindset, both before and after the resurrection, of just three individuals, as recorded for us in the Gospels. And the first one is Mary. Mary, obviously sad, obviously disillusioned, obviously feeling like the world was just crumbling around her. We can't be sure which Mary this is, although John tells us that, excuse me, that there were three Marys at the cross. So in John 19, verse 24, we read that near the cross of Jesus stood his mother, whose name was Mary, his mother's sister, whose name we don't know, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And then, of course, there's still another Mary involved. There's Mary, who was Lazarus and Martha's sister. So we don't know how all of those Marys fit into the whole picture. But at least at the cross, we're told there were three Marys. And then in John chapter 20, verse 1, we read that early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, did you notice that when you came in? It was still dark. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw the stone had been removed from the entrance. So this Mary, it seems, who came there was Mary Magdalene. She's the one from whom seven demons had been cast out. Peter tells us through Mark, that in Mark chapter 16 and verse 9, that when Jesus rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene. And John then picks up the story. This Mary, whose life had been turned upside down, everything that she pinned her hopes in, had come crumbling. Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." This person that she has spent the last 3 years of her life with didn't recognize him. I remember one of the videos about this being that as she looks up, there's the silhouette of Jesus because the sun was behind him. And one could understand that she was unsure of who this person was. But she didn't recognize Jesus, not by sight or by the sound of his voice. And is that how you feel about your spiritual life? That maybe it's been a long time since you've seen, heard, experienced Jesus. And you're told that he's there, and you look up and you just, there's nothing. And your life seems to be crumbling around you. Your circumstances are just mounting up, just getting worse and worse. Your family is falling apart. You're at loggerheads in your home, maybe even in your business. And you've read the scriptures, you've had your quiet times, you've prayed, you've watched the videos, you've attended church, you've sung the songs, and yet something inside is just flat and dead. Jesus seems to be far away and you don't recognize him because you're so sad and disillusioned. Are you in that position? Sometimes you feel so heartbroken that you can't see beyond your tears, whether those are real tears or just spiritual tears in your heart. Mary was like that. She was sad, she was confused, she was heartbroken, she was overwhelmed by the circumstances, what she had just seen. She was at the cross. She was one of those who stuck it out. But the passage continues, you know that, you know the story. Jesus said to her, "Mary." And it was when he spoke her name that she recognized him. "Mary," said Jesus. She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." And you know what happens. And she goes and tells the disciples. And Jesus says to this woman who was so devastated, he gives her a very special commission. Go and tell my brothers. Go and tell my brothers. It's very interesting that the first person who was instructed to share the gospel, to go and preach the gospel, if you like, was a woman. Just thought we should note that. first person with the good news was a woman. And this morning, Jesus is speaking to you by name. That's what we're remembering. What is your name? Have you seen him recently? Have you experienced his closeness recently? Or has it been a matter of, you've tried so hard, you're going through the motions, and it just feels so dead and dry, and like things are just crumbling around you? That's how Mary felt. And Jesus speaks your name now. Your name. Morning. Put your name. The second person I want us to look at, obviously the resurrection transformed things for Mary, but the second person I want us to look at is Thomas. Known, come down through history as being doubting Thomas. Thomas, the unbelieving one. You know what? I probably identify more with Thomas than anyone else. I think it's unfair to call him doubting Thomas. Maybe he was just realistic Thomas. I mean, he knew that Jesus had died on the cross. He knew that. And now they're telling him this wonderful, well, weird story about Jesus being alive. And so in John chapter 20, the story carries on. Now Thomas, called Didymus, which means the twin, by the way, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand in his side, I will not believe it." Thomas, the realist, not doubting, just being real. He was saying, "I know he's dead. I know he's dead. And now you're expecting me to believe some kind of miracle or fairy tale? What is this? Come on." It had been good while it lasted, being with Jesus. But the adventure was over. And now he's saying, "You're asking just too much of me to believe this story. You're asking too much. Rising from the dead? Please. I know you're sincere, but I can't believe it." Are you in that position here this morning? You know that it's Easter. And you've come together with people who are celebrating the fact that he's risen. And maybe there's something inside him that says, "Hey, I'm a realist. I talked about faith and believing something, but I'm a realist. I know dead people don't rise. I used to believe as a teenager, but over the years, I just don't know. I sensed the Holy Spirit in days past, but it's been dry as dust for some years now. And I'm not sure that it wasn't all just emotionalism. And yet you're here this morning. And maybe in your mind you're still saying, I'm not sure I go with all of this. I really want to believe it, but I'm not sure that I can." And Thomas was the one, just like you, who found it really hard to believe. Impossible, in fact. Just a bridge too far. But the story again continues. A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. And though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See, my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Is that what he's saying to you this morning? Your name? Stop doubting and believe. Maybe your intellect is just too much. It says, I just can't deal with this. And then Jesus had told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. And maybe you find yourself saying, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief, because I don't know how to cope with this. And Jesus meets Thomas at the point of his doubts. And you know what? I understand that. I'm one who understands. I think I've said it before in this church from this platform, that I find faith hard. It's not something that comes naturally to me. There are others. My wife's one of them. She's grown up. She's always believed. She's always believed. She doesn't find that hard. I haven't had that experience. And I wouldn't presume to say that I often have intellectual doubts, but I have doubts. I have doubts. And I want to urge you, what I do is I need to put myself in the place where other people believe. And I put myself in a place where I can hear other rational, reasonable responses to the gospel. And I encourage you to do the same. Put yourself in a place where you can hear some intellectual arguments in support of the facts of the Gospels. Because there's sound reasons for believing in the reasonableness of the resurrection. And it needs to start with this question. If you're saying resurrection doesn't happen, you've got to ask yourself this question. So where is the body? Now, there are a number of answers given to what could have happened on that resurrection day. What could have been stolen? They could have gone to the wrong tomb. He could have not died, which is what the Muslims claim. And there are answers to all of those things. But no one has ever said, here was the body. Here's the body. So you've got to ask yourself, what happened to the body? There's no proof. But it's not unreasonable, hear me, it's not unreasonable to believe that the only explanation is the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And too many adults are trying to live their lives, their Christian lives, as adults, based on what they learned at Sunday school. My brother, my sister, please, it goes way beyond that. And there are adequate, reasonable responses. And as I said, there's no proof, but there is reason to believe. There is reason to believe. But this morning you've come to put yourself in place of, amongst people who are encountering Jesus, and you're wondering. This morning he's calling you by name. That's why you're here. And maybe even with those questions that you have surging through your head, even through your heart, just to know that you are not alone and that the reason you're here is because Jesus has been speaking to you. He's calling you by name. And the third and last person I want us to look at this morning is, of course, Peter. Peter is so self-conscious, aware of the fact that he has blown it. Aware of the fact, convicted about the fact that he has failed Jesus. He has failed him. And it happens sometime later, after a night of fishing, the disciples have moved up from Jerusalem. The message through Mary Magdalene was, tell my brothers to go up to Galilee and I'll meet them there. So they go up to Galilee and they're at the Sea of Galilee, and it appears as if Jesus has not rocked up. And so from verse 21 of John, the chapter of John, verse 15, I beg your pardon, chapter 21. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these? Do you love me more than they do? Or he could have been saying, do you love me more than this group of people here? Doesn't matter what exactly the question was, but notice Simon's response. He says, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John. Notice the name again. Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And the third time he said it to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Are you in a position where you used to be strong in the faith, you used to make bold statements about Jesus, and for the past months or years, you haven't spoken about him to anybody? Mainly because you know that there's stuff that's actually wrong in your life. You've messed up badly. It's Simon's failure. Caused him to feel hurt about Jesus asking him again, do you love me? He's saying, Lord Jesus, you know that I have failed you. You know that I denied you. And you? Is it your adultery that's causing you to wonder? Is it your cheating in business? Is it that you've been caught up in a whole lot of lies and deceit to people all around you? Are you addicted to stuff that you know just shouldn't be part of your life as a follower of Jesus, whether it's gambling or pornography or alcohol or drugs? You know that this thing has got a hold on you and you're feeling like you're such a mess and you've tried so hard to stop. You're saying, how could Jesus ever come to me? Maybe you're just tired of the Christian scene. This whole scene, this whole church life, this whole talking about Jesus being alive, rising from the dead, coming down, virgin birth, all of this stuff, and you're just tired of it. And this morning, I have asked him to speak to you and to confront you with the fact that he is alive. Not just because I'm saying so or because we sing songs about it, but because you actually have a sense that he's here and he's saying, Simon, son of John, Mary, Thomas. Maybe you're like Peter, conscious of big failure in your life. Not that anyone could see. Anyone here beating their wife? Of course, the story does, I left out sentences that are so important. In John 21, do you love me? Jesus said, feed my lambs. You know that I love you, Lord. Feed my lambs. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Just as Jesus restores Peter to a ministry that has transformed the planet, transformed the history of our existence here on planet Earth. So Jesus says, I want to use you, even if you have messed up really badly. And one of the ministries of the resurrection Christ is that he takes people who are broken. And maybe no one else can see your brokenness, but you know it inside. And says, do you love me? Do you love me? And come on, I want to use you. What a bunch. I haven't even mentioned the disciples. I couldn't go into all that this morning as well. They were so afraid. They locked themselves in a room. They were afraid. Have you been overwhelmed by your circumstances lately? Do you find yourself doubting so much of what goes on? Are you struggling with the fact that you haven't been as you've wanted to be, as you almost believe you should be, not because church people have told you, but because you know that before God, that's how you need to be. And it's not like that for you. For whatever reason, you find yourself here this morning. And I have, as I said, I have prayed that the Lord Jesus would speak to you by name this morning. Commission you to continue serving. But some of you, of course, are delighted. Some of you are glad you're here. You're full of faith. You're exuberant about the fact that you know Jesus is alive and you're able to celebrate with all your heart and delighted to do that. But some are sad. Sad because of, I don't know, whatever reasons you may have. But just that, the sadness. Others, maybe you were dragged along by your family. Although looking around here, it doesn't look like there are too many grandkids to drag you here this morning. Maybe you've come just to come and have a look-see. What are they going to do this morning? Others of you, you've been following Jesus for some while. You know you're messing up, but you really want to turn this around, and you're asking him to do that for you. But hear this. You're here this morning because God wants you here. You're here this morning because he wants you to hear what his word says. And he wants to use you. And as Matthew wrote, a bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not snuff out. And he knows you by name. And the living Lord Jesus loves you by name. I don't know that. Well, he said so when he was talking about himself as being the good shepherd in John chapter 10. And he says, the gatekeeper opens the gate to him, and the sheep recognize his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. This morning, in your head right now, won't you say your name? Your name.
He sang the words, and then there were oceans, there was me, designing nature's blend. With one motion, he calmed the sea. From his earth there came the winds and the mountain screams his name. Yes, he knows me. Yes, he knows me. Drowning glory, yet he sees me. Wise and mighty, yet he loves me. And chose a journey filled. So I know him. His hands in everything, painting sunsets, bringing rain. Yet through my wanderings, you were calling. Oh.
weaknesses, our strugglings. And yet you, the living one, still call us by name. Lord, you know that we love you. Pray that this morning, as you go out of here, that you will know him, not just about him, but that you will know him and sense his love for you, because he knows you. He knows you. So may you know the peace of God that goes beyond any human understanding. May you know that peace, experience that peace, the peace that comes with the living Lord Jesus, as you go from here today. And then,